The story of the 90s rave era springs to new life in the photos of Dance Floor Thunderstorm, Land of the Free, Home of the Rave, a photo book created by dance music photojournalist Michael Tullberg. The book delves into the Southern California underground rave scene of the 90s and early aughts, a movement Tullberg considers impactful to this day.
Because I genuinely felt and still feel that this is one of the most important eras in modern American pop culture. The rise of the rave scene was really a seismic shift in the way that entertainment was presented to an audience, meaning taking out of the conventional concert entertainment, doing it on a very much a street level, do-it-yourself sort of thing.
All the images and words present in Dance Floor Thunderstorm are Tullberg's, capturing the lives and memories of both artists and ravers in a manner both artistic and explicit. The idea for the photo book came about in 2009, well after the underground's beginnings. Tullberg realized the rave days never received a formal story, or for that matter, an accurate one.
The only real mainstream coverage of the rave scene was very dismissive at best and hostile at worst. I thought that was tremendously unfair, especially because of all the positive aspects that came out of the rave scene.
Tullberg found the scene, or rather, the scene found him, in 1996, at a Burbank rave called Landing 2. Though it ended in a bust, the experience changed Tullberg's entire life.
Before the police and their canine units shut down the whole thing, I immediately got what was going on and what was going on the dance floor, the interactions between the DJs and the audience. It was obvious.
Rather than bemoan the status the mainstream ascribed to rave culture as drug-riddled debauchery, Tullberg instead sought to fix the narrative entirely. The images collected in Dance Floor Thunderstorm are not refined or posed, but straightforward, honest depictions of a scene flourishing with neither the support nor the inhibitions of conventional culture. To capture this new territory, Tullberg played with different aspects of photography, ensuring the feeling of the picture was just as impactful as its face.
This is how I developed a lot of my photographic techniques to replicate, you know, that energy going on. I would use like very high-speed films. I would move the camera in lines to create swirls with the lights. I would use multiple strobe units with different colored gels by myself. All these very simple techniques, when you can combine them, they can produce some really spectacular effects, which replicated the spectacular atmosphere that was going on at that party.
Dance Floor Thunderstorm also strives to highlight the autonomy of the rave scene. During the 90s, dance music received little to no mainstream support, and its self-sufficiency blew Tullberg away.
The fact that this scene could marshal artists and event producers, sound system producers, it was really like a perfect storm. All these resources coming together, more or less by themselves, without any major corporate support, no major record label support, no major advertising or PR campaigns in the mainstream sense. I mean, none of this was going on.
It became a learning curve for all involved, including Tullberg. In addition to fighting against the technical limitations of pre-digital cameras, Tullberg felt the need to cultivate an artistic style he felt better conveyed that dance floor energy.
The whole point was to put my own artistic spin on it, because I didn't want to simply just document the scene. Anybody can document anything. I was also taking inspiration from painting, specifically the Impressionist and Post-Impressionist era.
Tullberg actually draws many comparisons between the Impressionist movement and the documentation of the rave scene, how both embraced areas of culture deemed uncouth or unbecoming. He also drew parallels between the stylistic choices of Impressionist painting and electronic music, how both are refined for a lasting impact, he says.
It's not just the subject matter, but again, the energy, which of course was what Impressionism is really all about. It's not about realism, it's about impressions, it's about that energy and how it affects you. Yes.
Tullberg also found such energy most present in Los Angeles's rave scene, the hub of American rave culture during the late 90s and early aughts. As Tullberg puts it, a combination of good weather and being an entertainment capital helped LA's scene develop into a thriving underground.
We had the warehouses here, certainly, but like I said, we also had the desert. We had parties in the mountains. We had parties on the beach. And the other reason was that more big-name DJs globally people like Oakenfold and Cox, you know, and Fatboy Slim. They were coming through L.A. on a regular basis. So we became very, very spoiled in that regard.
Though he already covered various aspects of Los Angeles club life, Tolberg felt the inclusiveness of electronic music made for much better subject matter and much more fun. In rave culture, he says, the connection, or the energy as Tolberg calls it, present between the DJ and the dance floor feels quite like nothing else. Here, he says, you, as a member of the audience, are equally involved in the equation.
Raving was really, the artist was only half of the equation, the other half was the audience. And the audience was responding in such a gleeful, uninhibited, off-the-wall manner that you could not find at other places. It didn't matter where you came from, it didn't matter what your social status was, or your religion, or race, or whatever. It was basically in one criteria, which was, do you like the music? If you did, then bingo, you're in.
Tolberg further notes how the underground aspect of raving never fully dissipated. Almost any given weekend, he can find a warehouse party put together by a couple of people just looking to tap into that energy, he says.
Those are still around, and that's a very heartening thing. The fact that it isn't all corporate and it isn't all festivals is very much a good thing. And I really hope that more EDM kids will find these smaller parties, especially the older school ones with old school house DJs, and find out that it isn't all about the drop.
Just like raving is more than a bass drop, Dance Floor Thunderstorm is more than just a photo album. It is rave culture's full-fledged visual history, pieced together and articulated by a true believer in the scene. As any competent historian would, Tolberg and his collaborators recognized the value in the history they shared and what it meant if it disappeared.
If the raver's point of view isn't represented, a danger arises that that's going to be lost.
Instead, that history is now preserved, able to be shared by both younger and older generations. For younger generations, Dance Floor Thunderstorm provides a glimpse into the past which led to the current EDM boom. Additionally, Tolberg hopes it will expose younger EDM fans to tunes and DJs who never took off because the mainstream just never caught on.
One of the reasons why some EDM kids don't look back is because this music was not celebrated in the mainstream like any other genres have been. At least in the mainstream things like pop and rock and hip-hop, you have an industry behind there. You have a support system.
Behind the sound.
Yes, you're behind the sound. We did not have that with electronic music. On one hand, it made the rave scene a very tight-knit community and a very self-supporting, you know, community.
This tight-knit community certainly does remember the festivities and wonders depicted in Dance Floor Thunderstorm and is responding well to Tolberg's artistic illumination of the underground. Older ravers, he says, experience all sorts of emotions and memories with each page turn.
The old ravers, particularly the ones who were there, they're responding enthusiastically. It's like, oh my god, I remember this! Some of them get really excited when they find themselves in the book. There have been some cases of people finding their younger selves in there and just takes them right back. You know, it's like, oh my god, I'm right there all over again.
For Give a Beat, I'm Mick Jacobs.